In the open circuit case, the reaction at the electrode and the electrolyte interface will continue to separate the two charges, and it will continue to increase or provide the EMF until the electrostatic field from these separated charges is sufficient to arrest the further flow of the incoming charges. This is why an open circuit battery will not drain out early, and this is why it is recommended to open the battery in your cars when you know that the car is not likely to be used for a long time. Now, the overall electrochemical cell reaction can be understood as a two-step reaction, which we call two half reactions. One equation we write for the reduction reaction in which electrons are gained, and the second equation we write for the oxidation reaction in which electrons are given away. But remember that the number of electrons gained in the reduction half reaction must equal to the number of electrons lost in the oxidation half reaction. However, since the elements of the electrode are different, their internal energy levels are also different. The element which is giving away electron and the element which is accepting the electron, they both have different energy levels. This is the source of energy inside the cell, which will make the pushing of the charge from lower potential terminal to the higher potential terminal. The higher the energy difference per reacting charge, that is the electron, the higher the potential which you will be able to get from that particular cell. The cell's EMF therefore is calculated by adding the E values for each half reaction. So, we mathematically write E of the cell is equal to E of reduction minus E of oxidation. As the cell operates, the reactants are used up, and this may cause the EMF to decrease. We can see some typical half electrode potentials and remember them. For example, potassium has minus 2.92 volt, aluminium has minus 1.66 volt, zinc has minus 0.76 volt, nickel has minus 0.23 volt, copper has plus 0.35 volt, and silver has plus 0.80 volt. Thus, a typical copper zinc cell will have the EMF of 1.10 volts, whereas silver zinc cell will have the EMF of 1.56 volts, and the copper aluminium cell will give you the EMF of 2.00 volts. Similar other sources of EMF are solar cell or photodiode, where light energy is the external source of energy to separate the positive and negative charges. In thermionic emissions, it is the thermal energy, and in the fuel cells, it is again the chemical energy. Now, having understood all this about the EMF, that is electromotive force, and the Volta's batteries, we come to a very interesting consequential development out of these. This was the discovery of electromagnetic induction by Faraday in 1831. We can recall that the static electricity and magnetism were known to humanity for many decades. But the discovery of current, which came from the voltaic pile, was a very new phenomenon, and many scientists rushed to experiment with the current electricity. Among them, Oersted had observed and he had reported that a magnetic needle which was kept near a current switch flickered whenever the current was either switched off or on. So, if a current can influence a magnet, then will not a magnet influence the current? Faraday observed that whenever the magnetic flux changes, it gives rise to a voltage and consequently to a current, meaning that a changing magnetic flux is a source of EMF. Now, magnetic flux can be changed either by moving a magnet, say inside the coil of a metal conductor, or you move the coil itself and keep the two magnetic poles in a fixed position. In the simplest form, the electromagnetic induction produces or induces a voltage across a conductor which is moving through a magnetic field.